From awaytogarden.com and robinhoodradio.com, this is A Way to Garden with Margaret Roach, your weekly invitation to dig in and grow.
Now, this, as you probably know, is not gardenrant.com. That's another website altogether, one run by a whole group of talented garden writers. This is just A Way to Garden where you only get me. But whatever the name on the masthead, on today's show, I do want to rant a little and also to celebrate. And yes, there will be music. We haven't had a music show lately, not since June, when I threw myself an on-air birthday party. And like then, today, in lieu of a guest, I brought along some of my crazy collection of tunes. It's not another birthday yet, but an anniversary I want to note first, so let's start there. Almost precisely 7 years ago, I began to live full-time in my now nearly 30-year-old garden, a place that before that was home to me only on weekends for more than 20 years. When I lecture to garden clubs and other groups, I often begin by saying to the audience that I'm going to tell them a love story and how the garden is my beloved, my life partner, but how at first we had a long-distance love affair. Eventually, the time came that we either had to break up or one of us had to move. Guess who refused to budge? So here I am, thankfully, having uprooted from the city and corporate life and rerooted in the garden. Still in love with it, maybe more all the time as we grow older together. And it's a garden in the country, so I thought we'd start with an obscure version of a country song that pretty much describes my feeling about the place. It's called Big, Big Love and was recorded by Win Stewart in 1961.
Can't you tell my love's growing? Can't you feel it? Ain't it showing? Oh, you must be a-knowing. I've got a big, big love. It's not the kind to be concealing, just the kind to be revealing. It's not a little bitty feeling. I've got a big, big love. I think it's time we done some walking. I think it's time we done some talking. There's a great big moon above, and we've got a big, big love. This is not infatuation, but it's true love's sensation. It's not my imagination. I've got a big, big love for you. Can't you tell my love's a-growing? Can't you feel it? Ain't it showing? Oh, you must be a-knowing. I've got a big, big love. It's not the kind to be concealing, just the kind to be revealing. It's not a little bitty feeling. I've got a big, big love. I think it's time we've done some walking. I think it's time we've done some talking. There's a great big moon above, and we've got a big, big love. This is not infatuation, well, it's true love sensation. It's not my imagination. I've got a big, big love.
Now, as a footnote, I'm not even really sure how I came upon that recording, except perhaps it was in the late 80s or early 90s, when Katie Lang used to sing a cover of Big, Big Love, and I probably traced it back then to the original, which that was. So moving on to the first rant of the day, since my voluntary fall, or should I say escape from corporate success at the end of 2007 that landed me in rural splendor in a town of 300 people, I'm happy to admit I'm decidedly out of fashion, and not just because I seem to come up with outfits that are a little bit past their sell-by date, but because, frankly, who cares around here? It has recently been confirmed to me that when I'm outside in the act of gardening, I am also totally out of style, no matter what I'm wearing, and even a dinosaur, an outdated creature armed with a long-handled shovel and a hori-hori knife who actually weeds between the cracks and pushes wheelbarrows of mulch around instead of using products like that hideous landscape fabric. Yes, I am a dinosaur, I learned from nursery industry publications, because apparently nobody wants to actually garden anymore, as in the verb to garden. True. I learned this because I browsed the Garden Center trade publications to try to keep up on trends and innovations, and this unwelcome sentiment keeps coming up lately. The columnists in magazines like Ball Publishing's Green Profit quote industry consultants, the experts who give the keynote speeches to nursery owners at trade shows, who say this: people want gardens, but not gardening. They want the product, not the process. Instant is good, it seems. Chores, not so much. No surprise, then, I suppose, that what trended at the garden centers this year was what one industry insider called grab-and-go containers, pre-planted pots that deliver a little bit of instant garden. Even in the fastest trending category of all, edibles, one nursery told Greenhouse Grower magazine that they'd missed an opportunity to capitalize on the demand for more ready-to-go edibles for condominium owners, meaning pre-planted pots of vegetables and herbs. Now, I'm happy about the demand for those products, anything that gets people connecting with plants who might not do so otherwise. But I fear that when you simply grab and go, you miss out on some of the best parts that are hidden in the process. I'm all about digging in, not grabbing and going. To continue my rant, I must shout out the New York Times, where I once worked and which I rely on daily and love, but sometimes publishes stories it says are about gardening that aren't very helpful to gardeners. Like one not long ago about watering cans that didn't include one real watering can I could imagine using for anything productive, such as to water a plant. Admittedly, they were all very pretty, like those grab-and-go pre-planted containers probably are, but I'm going to hold out hope that a segment of the population will continue to get their hands dirty and even marvel at what comes out of that effort. Trendy or not, I love the process, and I've been at it too long to stop now, just like Etta James.
I've been loving you too long to stop now. A habit to me. I've been loving you way too long. I don't wanna stop now. With you, my life has been so wonderful. I can't stop now. You were kind, and your love is growing cold. My love is growing stronger as our affair grows old. I've been loving you.
Like she says, my love is growing stronger as our affair grows old. And that about sums up how I feel about the garden and gardening. And yes, this is also an example of the woo-woo part of my website's motto, Horticultural How-To and Woo-Woo. Next up, an in memoriam. My first pair of garden boots ever has finally died. Actually, they probably died a few years back when the rubber started to decay. But there they stood in my boot rack in the mudroom anyhow, even if they stopped enjoying outings into the soil. I was just so attached to them and all that we have been through together, all that we have accomplished. But I've been cleaning lately, paring down, tossing, and recycling, and I'm afraid the beat-up old boots will finally have to go. Though they have no label or logo on them, they are old-style Wellington-type boots in olive and brown, similar but not exactly like the current hunter boots that are so popular. Having to deaccession them reminded me that a painting of modest Gertrude Jekyll's well-worn gardening boots is in the collection of the Upper Crusty Tate Gallery in London. Somehow I doubt that my sorry English-made specials will ever make their way to anywhere but the local dump. Jekyll was the person regarded as most responsible for the renaissance of classic garden design in the 20th century, a prolific garden maker with more than 400 designs to her credit, and an even more prolific garden writer. I could read her work again and again, another testament, I suppose, to my dinosaur status, because judging from her legacy and the look of her boots, she was into gardening and not just the idea of gardens. So for my boots funeral, then, let's play the boot song of all boot songs from Nancy Sinatra.
You keep saying you got something for me, something you call love, but confess, you've been a messin' where you shouldn't have been a messin', and now someone else is getting all your best. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you. You keep lying when you ought to be truthing, and you keep losing when you ought to not bet. You keep saying when you ought to be a-changing. Now what's right is right, but you ain't been right yet. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you. You keep playing where you shouldn't be playing, and you keep thinking that you'll never get burned. Ha! I just found me a brand new box. Yeah. And what he knows you ain't had time to learn. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you. Are you ready, boots? Start walking.
Okay, so probably by now you're saying these aren't garden songs, and you are right, but they make me smile, and that's not nothing in life. As I've confessed on previous music shows, I hear a connection to gardening in most everything, and have a stash of whole playlists in my iTunes library themed to topics like trees and weather and roses and sunshine and so on. I have just one song for the genus Prunus, or cherry, however, and also one for pruning, as in managing a cherry or other tree or shrub with a shears and saw. My Prunus song is by J.J. Cale, and here's a snippet.
Cherry, I'd like to love you. Cherry, will you love me too? Someday I will take you away. That's all I wanna do. I love you forever, Cherry. Will you love me too? Sweet as a morning sunrise, fresh as a mountain dew. Someday I will love you, Cherry. Will you love me too? I need you forever, Cherry. Will you need me too?
So what about pruning, which, by the way, I'm going to be doing a lot of after a particularly nasty 10 or so inches of very heavy wet snow fell the day before Thanksgiving, bowing most every woody plant in the garden to the ground, splaying them all open, with many snapping in the process. It will be goodbye not just to my old boots, but also to the beautiful Coosa dogwood by the front door, I can see for certain, and who knows what else is a goner. Good thing I like the process of gardening, huh? Nature keeps presenting opportunities to engage in, and I keep engaging. So what's my go-to pruning song in my funny garden music collection? Of course, it has to be the much-covered Cat Stevens one about first cut is the deepest, and I like the soul version from the 60s that P.P. Arnold had a hit with.
Torn it apart, and he's taken almost all that I've got. But if you wanna try to love again, baby, I'll try to love again. But I know the first cut is the deepest, baby. I know the first cut is the deepest.
Thank you.
There was no wind in Wednesday storm, but I want to mention the wind because especially in winter, it's very windy where I garden, and I'll confess, it's the element I fear the most, but it's also a helper in various ways. Wind, the motion of air molecules, is a powerful pollinator through a process called anemophily, which translates as love of wind from the Greek. The Forest Service says about 12% of the world's flowering plants, notably grasses and cereal crops, and as much as 20% of all plants are pollinated by wind, including most conifers and many other trees. Since wind-pollinated crops don't need to attract pollinators, their flowers have no need to come in flashy colors or smell good or provide nectar or even have petals to land on. So imagine beets and chard and spinach, all wind-pollinated, when they come into flower. Not much to look at, are they? So think about it. This is just another example of the ancient secret deals brokered between plants and animals that keep drawing me to gardening in a deeper way than just the mere aesthetic of those grab-and-go containers. But I'd have to count wind, not cold, despite my Zone 5B climate, as the most destructive force, bringing down or splitting apart woody plants, desiccating evergreens in winter, generally making plants thirstier faster in a world where water is in ever shorter supply. Sometimes all the wind means is a few stray leaves, but normally it has nastier tricks in mind. I'm not the wind's lover, no anemophiliac, if that's even a word. Not me. It's time to batten down the hatches for the next outburst, and as ever, I am watching and listening. But I'm staying put right here, unlike Nina Simone in our last song. So see you next week, and don't forget, subscribe to the podcast on Stitcher or iTunes and never miss an episode, and watch out for chilly winds.
Chilly winds don't blow. Oh Lord, going where chilly winds don't blow. I'm going where chilly winds don't blow, baby. Where the chilly winds they don't blow. There will be red roses round my door. Honey, baby, there will be red roses round my door. I'm going there, 'cause there they'll welcome me for sure, baby. Where the chilly winds, they don't blow. I'm going where my daddy's waiting for me.
A Way to Garden with Margaret Roach is a joint production of awaytogarden.com and the smallest NPR station in the nation, Robin Hood Radio.